Welcome to New Salem's virtual worship experience. Please keep watching after the sermon to hear important information and updates.
Good morning. My name is Dawn Brown. I'm a member of the New Salem Baptist Church Prayer Ministry. Our scripture for today will be from Psalm 96, verses 1 through 10. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his wonders among all peoples. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Give to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The world also is firmly established. It shall not be moved. He shall judge the peoples righteously. Let us pray. Father God, we bless you and thank you, Lord, for this time that you have given us, Lord, to come to worship, to praise, and to magnify your name. God, you are awesome, God. And so we just thank you, Lord, for every opportunity we get to come into your presence, oh God, and to lift up your name. Father, though this year has come with its challenges, Father God, we want to celebrate the many blessings that we have enjoyed this year as well. Father, as we come into this Christmas season, Lord, let us continually be reminded of the offering of Jesus Christ for our salvation and redemption, Lord. We bless you and thank you even now, Lord, for continuing to be with us and continuing to comfort us and keep us, Lord. We pray your blessings over our pastor at this time, Lord, as he brings a word that will be both light and life to those who hear it. Father, we thank you and praise you, and we ask that we worship you, Lord, in spirit and in truth, and that you hear our praises, Lord God, and that you are yet well pleased. We bless you and thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know? did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? And that sleeping child you're holding is a great.
Thank you. Good morning. It's a great day to be alive. It's a great day to be alive. We greet you on the last Sunday of 2020. We are grateful for all that God has brought us through and continues to see us through. We're grateful for all that we have survived. But more importantly, we're grateful for God's faithfulness and his love. We bow our heads in a word of prayer. God, we come this morning, probably in a more intentional way than other times. We have seen you bring us through a year that we could have never dreamed that we would survive. God, there's been highs, there's been lows, there's been ups, and there's been downs. There's been gains, and there's been losses. But through it all, you have remained steadfast. You have remained ever loving, loving us, even when we walked away or were disillusioned or depressed. Whatever mood we had, God, your love remained consistent. And for that, we want to thank you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for loving us. It's your servant's prayer. Amen. As we move to the last part of 2020 and look forward to 2021, I want to begin a transition series from 2020 to 2021 because I have some discernment that this year has caused us, for some of us, the possibility or the chance to get away from God, to show some distance between us and God, to wonder if God really loves us, then why would he allow the kinds of things that have been allowed this year? So I want to talk about for the next few weeks how to get closer to God, how to get closer to God. Our verse, which is our theme for the next couple of weeks, is Romans 12, verse 2. Let's read it together. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Again, that's Romans, the 12th chapter, and the second verse. You've heard me say this many times during my tenure here at New Salem. The way you think determines the way you feel, and the way you feel determines the way you act. If you want to change something in your life that you don't like, you don't start with your actions. You don't even start with your feelings. You start with your thoughts. If you're acting depressed, it's because you feel depressed. And if you're feeling depressed, it's because you're thinking depressing thoughts. The key to transformation starts not in our actions, not in our behavior, not even in our body. It doesn't start with our will. It starts with our thoughts. And if you can change the way you think, that'll change the way you feel. And if you can change the way you feel, that'll change the way you act. This morning, we're going to take that principle out of Romans 12, 2, and apply it to all different kinds of areas of our lives over the next few weeks. Relational, physical, mental, spiritual, emotional, financial, and even vocational. We're going to look at the seven major areas of our life and how do we change the way I think about this so that I can feel about it differently. Then if I feel differently, it's going to change the way I act and the way I respond to other people. And that's called transformation. Transformation changes us from emptiness to fullness. Transformation changes us from defeat and failure to faith and victory. Transformation changes us from insecurity and inferiority to courage and to boldness. It helps us become all that God wants us to be. What I want to say in this first session this week, as we begin looking at our spiritual health, we're going to start with that, is that the further away you get from God, the more trouble you're going to have in your life. The more trials, the more difficulties, the more stress, the more things are going to go wrong because you're not cooperating with the one who created you. You're not following God's plan for your life. And the Bible says the way of the unrighteous is rough. It's full of thorns. It's difficult. It's a rocky road. The further I get away from God, the further I get away from God, the more trouble I'm going to have in my life. On the other hand, the closer I get to God, the more my life is going to be transformed. We can see all this through Scripture. Paul, when he finally met Jesus Christ face to face, he was radically transformed from a terrorist into the apostle of law. He wrote the most beautiful poem on love ever written, ever penned by humanity. Isaiah was transformed from a depressed person into a courageous person when he met God, when he got close to God. Moses got so close to God, the Bible says he was even transformed his appearance. People had to even look away from him. He almost glowed. He got so close to God that he got his light, and in him was no darkness at all. He was literally physically transformed. We all want to be close to God. You wouldn't be listening to this or watching this if you didn't want to be close to God in some way. But the Bible says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We each have turned into our own way. In other words, like sheep, we tend to wander. We tend to go astray. We have to drift off sometimes. You don't have to teach sheep to drift. They just do it naturally. By their very nature, they just kind of wander off, and the shepherd has to bring them back in, and they'll walk off the cliff. Sheep aren't really that bright an animal. They'll walk into a den of wolves and all kinds of difficult and dangerous situations. Sheep tend to wander. The Bible says all we, that's me and you, like sheep tend to go astray. We don't tend to stay close to God. We tend to wander off. So this morning, as we start this transformation conversation, if I said the closer you get to God, the more you're going to be transformed, we need to talk about how do we get close to God, how do we stay close to God, and if you've fallen away from God, how do you get back in that close relationship to God? During this pandemic, it could have been easy to stray because we have changed our routines. Sunday morning is not as normal as it used to be. We don't go to church. Sometimes we now can tape church or have it and see it when we want to. Our patterns have changed. We've got to get back to saying, ladies and gentlemen, how do I stay close to God? Some of you are a point to a time in your life where you might say, I remember when I was really felt God's presence. I was close to God. I could sense his friendship. I could sense the fellowship. There was a joy in my life. But somehow I've lost that. It's like you let the air out of the balloon. How do I get back to God if I've kind of wandered away, kind of lost that spark? Because if I'm not close to God, I don't have the power to make all the other transformations. Fortunately, there's a story in the Bible on how to get back to God and how to get close to the Father. It's one of those famous stories in the Bible. Jesus tells the story. It's the story of the prodigal son, or sometimes it's called the story of the loving father, because it's really more about the father than it is about the son. The story is located in Luke 15. Let me read you the story and then pull back some principles out of this story to help you transform your life spiritually. Luke 15 started at verse 11 through 24. Jesus told this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, give me my share of your estate now instead of waiting until you die. So his father divided his wealth between his sons. A few days later, the younger son packed all his belongings and left home to live in a distant land. He's already getting away from the father. He's getting distance from the father. He got as far away from his father as he could. He goes to a distant land and he squandered the gift he'd been given. We've all done that. And wasted his life and money on wild parties and reckless living. About the time all his money ran out, a severe famine hit the land, and he began to starve because he was left with nothing. Now he's getting pretty hungry. The only job he could find was feeding swine on a farm. He became so desperate and hungry that even the pig slop he was feeding the swine looked good to him. But no one could give him anything for his hunger. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "This makes no sense. At my father's home, even the lowest paid workers eat well, while I'm far away dying of hunger. I'm going to return home to my father and humbly say, 'Father, I have sinned against both God and you, and I'm not worthy to be a part of this family or called your son. But I, please just make me one of your servants who works for you. I'm not even a family member. Just hire me out as a servant. Make me one of your servants who works for you.'" With that attitude, he headed back home to his father. But while the son was still a long distance off, he hadn't got all the way back home yet. His father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran out to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said, he had a prepared speech, "Father, I've sinned against both God and you, and I'm no longer worthy of being called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring me the finest robe in our house and put it on him. Then get my signet ring of his finger, put it on his finger, and shoes on his feet. Then roast the calf we've been fattening. We're going to celebrate with feast of eating and drinking, for this child of mine who was distant and dead, but now he's back and alive. He was lost, but now he's found. So let the party begin." That's a major story. It's an incredible story. It tells the story of how every one of us tend to wander away from our God, wander away from the Father who made us, wander away from the God who loves us. The son starts off saying, "God, Dad, Father, I want you to give me what's rightfully mine." At that point, it's all about me. Give me mine. It's very self-centered life. That's where we usually start in life. Give me mine. God, give me mine. I want mine now. And by the way, I'm in a hurry. I want it, and I want it now, and I can't pay for it, but I'll put it on credit. So we're always in a hurry. Give me mine now. So he takes off. Packs up, heads off to the bright lights of Jerusalem. There he wastes his money and his time and his energy on wine, women, and song. Some things just don't change. And he really gets messed up, and he hits rock bottom. He becomes homeless. Then on top of that, the nation goes into a national recession because there's a famine in the land. Now nobody has anything to eat, so nobody's going to give a panhandler, a street guy, a beggar anything to eat because they don't have anything to eat. He can't even find a job. Things go from bad to worse. Finally, he finds a farm where he's hired himself out to do the worst job on the farm, slopping pigs. For a Jew, that was the worst possible thing. It could not have been kosher for him to slop pigs or even touch a pig. You're not supposed to have anything to do with pork. He gets the worst job a Jewish child could get, slopping pigs. He gets so hungry and he gets so desperate. He's even saying to himself, "This pig slop is starting to look good." You got to be seriously desperate if you think pig slop looks good. And it says nobody gave him anything. But there's a moment. The text says he wises up and he comes to his senses. The servants, the poorest paid men in my dad's employment, eat better than this. What in the world am I doing? He knows he doesn't deserve his father's love. He just wasted half of his father's inheritance, all his dad earned his entire life, working to earn. He says, I know what I'm going to do. I'm not going to go home and ask my father to just accept me back in the family. I'm just going to go home and say to my dad, hired me. I'd rather be a servant in your house than be in a distant country starving to death. He was willing to trade his sonship for servanthood. And you know the rest of the story. We saw the father's response. From this story, we gained some things on how to get back to God. I don't know where you are today. I don't know what this pandemic has done to you. I don't know how your relationship is. You may be way, 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 way far away. Maybe you haven't been in church for years. Maybe you haven't watched church for years, but this is your Sunday. Or maybe you've been a little closer, or maybe a little bit closer than that, or maybe you've just been not watching us for a week or two. You've had one of those weeks where you thought, I really don't feel God's presence in my life. And yet, we all long to be close to God. How do I get back to Him? Well, there's a few things you need to do. There's a pathway back to spiritual transformation. The first thing you need to do is you need to do what this young man did. You need to get to a point where you get fed up with your life. I get fed up with my circumstances. I get fed up with the way I've been living. I just get sick and tired of being sick and tired. I'm not going to live this way anymore. The bottle won't do for me. The weed, all the stuff I've been trying, it doesn't work. I'm too stressed out. I'm too lonely. I'm too depressed. I'm overworked. I'm busy. I'm too lonely. I'm too depressed. I'm overworked. I'm busy. I don't even like myself. Why would anybody else like me? I don't even like me. This living with me has become too much. I don't really like the life I'm living right now. Nothing is going to happen in your life in the next few weeks until you first get dissatisfied with the way you're living. If you think I'm fine, I'm just okay, I don't need any change in my life, then you might as well take the next few Sundays off. No sense in you listening to us. But if you're tired of being stressed out all the time, if you're tired of being frustrated, if you're tired of being overworked, if I'm tired of feeling distant from God, then guess what? This is the right time for you. Because you got to get desperate. You got to get hungry. You got to get anxious for a change. Nothing happens until you get fed up. Passage of scripture, it says this. He wasted it all. He had nothing left. He got desperate and hungry, and he finally came to his senses. That's where transformation starts. Are you there yet? Is it not that okay? God will just let you stay there, and he'll allow a little rain in your life. And if that doesn't work, he'll allow a little bit more rain in your life. And if that doesn't work, he'll send a storm. Why? Because God loves you just the way you are, but he loves you too much to let you stay that way. He will not let you waste your life. When God wants to get your attention, he comes and knocks on the door. If we ignore it, if we just knocks again. Then if we ignore it, he knocks again. And if we ignore it, he'll blow the door down. Some of you have had the door blown down in your life. You've lost your job. You've lost your marriage. You lost a loved one. You lost a friend. You've lost something, and you're on the point of almost losing yourself. Why? Because God does everything he does in your life out of love. He does not want you to miss him, and he does not want you to waste your life. You know that old phrase? You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make the horse drink. That's true, but you can't add salt to his oats and make him thirsty. God often makes us thirsty by putting salt in our oats. When you start saying, I'm just so unsatisfied with my life. I just don't like the way I'm living. I don't like this. Hello, that's God knocking at your door. The first step in transformation is for you to get disgusted, to get discontent, to get fed up with the way you're living. Here's what Jeremiah 29:13 says. God, you'll find me when you get serious about finding me, and I want it more than anything else. God is not going to reveal himself if I just kind of want to do it on a casual, just kind of part-time hobby. I got to get fed up with the way I'm living. There's got to be more to life than this. There's got to be a better way to live than this. There's got to be a saner way. I've got to get to the point where I want more. So I got to get fed up. But the second thing that has to happen for transformation to really start really going is I got to learn to own up to my sin. First, I get fed up. Second, I own up. I own up to my own sin. That's the second thing this young man did. First, he got fed up. But then in verse 17 and 18, he says, when he came to his senses, this is crazy. I can't maintain this lifestyle. I've been living right now. It's just not sustainable. It's not fulfilling, and it's not sustainable. When he came to his senses, that is, you wake up. To live without God does not make sense. To live without God is not rational. To live without the Creator who made you is not logical. It doesn't make sense. When he came to his senses, I have sinned against God and you. Nothing is going to happen until you get to stage two. Stage two is you just got to own it. I need to face up to the fact that I have not been living God's way. I've been living my way, doing my thing, acting about how I feel. I've been doing it my way. I've been doing it the way I think is best. I've been doing it in a way that protects all my fears. I've been doing it in a way that tries to control everything around me, even though I know I can't control it. I'm still trying to control it all. I'm getting tired of holding on to all the controls. I'm about ready to resign as general manager of the universe because I've noticed it isn't cooperating with me. So I own it. But what is it that I own up to? I own up to my sin. When he came to his senses, the text says he said, I have sinned. Isaiah 59:2. Your sins have separated you from God and have hidden his face from you. Have you ever prayed and you felt like God was a million miles away? Have you ever prayed and felt like your prayers were bouncing off the ceiling? Have you ever prayed and felt like it's like there was this veil between you and God? I can't see God. I can't hear God. I can't feel God. I feel like I'm just talking to myself. Where does that come from? Your sins have separated you from your God, and he's hidden his face from you. That's where it comes from. It comes from your sin and it comes from my sin. If you feel far from God, I want to ask you a question. Who moved? God didn't move. God didn't go on vacation. God didn't move away to a foreign country. God has always been there and he's never not been there. He loves you unconditionally, but if you feel far from God, you're the one who moved. You moved away by giving your love to someone else. When you give anything else your love, that's a word for it in the Bible. It's called an idol. We think idols are these little stone things that people bow down and worship. No, an idol can be your car. An idol can be your job. An idol can be an outfit. An idol can be the way you look. Anything that you love more than God becomes an idol. The first and second commandments say, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make any false idols. Money can be an idol. Success can be an idol. God forbid, golf can be an idol. These are not bad things. They're just not deserving of first place in my life. So I own up to my sins. Your sins have separated you from God. The fact is this. You're as close to God as you choose to be. You can't really blame anybody else. You can't blame your spouse. You can't blame your mom, your dad, your brother, your sister. You can't blame people. It's being lame when you blame other people for your spiritual condition. You got to take responsibility for where you are. If my husband was just a more dedicated believer, really? If my girlfriend was just more on fire for Christ, really? You are as close to God as you choose to be. The fact is, you haven't been desperate yet. You haven't been fed up enough. You're not desperate enough to know God. If we were to hold you underwater, you would struggle. But when you really start running out of breath, you would really struggle because you would be desperate for air. When you're really that desperate, you don't just get fed up, you own up and you say, I got to know God. You're as close to God as you choose to be. When I own up and I say to God, I've blown it, I've been going my own way, I've been doing my own thing, I've been doing my own thing. When I do that, what is God's response to me facing up to my sin? Does he go, yeah, let me tell you what else you've been doing? No, God never rubs it in. When I come and say, God, you know what I've done. I'm really sorry. What does he do? Here's the prayer you should pray. It's right there in Psalms 51. David prays this prayer after he committed adultery and killed Uriah, Bathsheba's husband. That's a pretty serious sin. Psalms 51, verses 1 through 4, look at what David says. Be merciful to me, O God, because of your constant love, because of your great mercy, wipe away my sins. Wash away all my evil and make me clean. I recognize my faults and I am conscious that I have sinned against you. I have sinned against you. I recognize my faults. That means to own up, to face up to my sins. I own up to my sins. I recognize my fault. What is God's response when I own up to my sins, when I face up? Look at the next verse. The Lord says, no matter how deep the stain of your sins, I can remove it. I can make you as clean and as freshly fallen snow. He says, no matter what we've done, no matter who we've done it with, he can remove it. This verse is the OxyClean verse of the Bible. He says, I can take any stain that you have made, I can take it out. I know you and I struggle with our past. We think it's going to haunt us the rest of our life. But God says, I can remove the sting from that stain. This is the stain remover verse of the Bible. And this is how we begin to transform our lives so that we can move closer to God. And for the rest of the ways we do this, we'll see you in the new year. God, thank you for reminding us. You love us so much that you're willing to forgive us of things we haven't forgiven ourselves of. God, if we're honest, this past year has been some kind of year. And it's given us opportunity to walk away, to stray away, to move away from you in our consistent worship, our consistent spiritual time, our consistent spiritual time and our devotions. But God, this morning we admit we want to move closer back to you, and we start the journey today. We know it's going to take some time. We know it's going to take some discipline. But God, we've become desperate. We've become hungry. We want you more than we want anything else. So God, we claim it today. It's in your son's name. Amen, amen, and amen. We open up the doors to church and invite you to become a part of this family of God. Ladies and gentlemen, this thing is between you and him. You don't have to ask anybody else's permission. God, I simply want to get closer to you. I want to get back to the way things were. God, I realize you didn't move, I moved. But now, God, I want to make a U-turn in my life and begin to move closer back to you. And so, God, I've finally gotten fed up. God, I'm finally owning up. And God, I'm choosing you today to be my king and my father, and I want to be your son, and I want you to be my Lord. God, I choose you today. You can do that three ways: by connecting to God. You can send a text here to the New Salem Church at 614-568-4858. You can also send an email to nsprayerministry@newsalemcares.com, or you can visit our website at church.newsalemcares.com/connect. We invite you to become. What a great way to end the year, and even better way to start the year. Well, we are blessed. We are here at the last Sunday of the year. It is giving time again. God has been faithful. We're still trying to do what God has called us to do. Thank you for all of you who were able to help us this past week be able to give to the Bike Foundation and the bike giveaway that we were able to do with East Linden. We were able to give away 60 new bikes. We're grateful for that, just the time, even though it's a pandemic, to see those kids' faces and their parents' faces. God doesn't close up shop because our buildings may not be open. Ministry still goes on and need still goes on. So we want to ask you to continue to be supportive of the ministry and things we're trying to do both inside the community and outside the community. These are challenging times for us, and we ask you to still remain faithful in your stewardship. So you can give them the following ways. There are five options. Visit church.newsalemcares/give. That's number one. Number two, you can use the Shelby Next app. Number three, go to Cash App, $NSCares. The fourth thing you can do is text your amount to 614-333-0656, or you can stop by the church and leave your gift here at the church on 2956 Cleveland Avenue. Please, we ask you to still remain faithful as we seek to close up this year. We ask you to now stay tuned and get ready for our top five announcements. We're excited about what's going to happen. Please stay tuned for our virtual information on our virtual watch night service. It's going to be something new and different, but we're looking forward to how we close out this year virtually.
Greetings, New Salem family, and all of our special guests. These are your top five announcements for this week. Number one, mark your calendar, save the date for New Salem's annual Watch Night service, December 31st, 10 p.m. to midnight, on Facebook Live and YouTube. We will bring in the new year virtually with a little fun and entertainment, music, prayer, worship, and a powerful word as we extend our faith and hope in Jesus Christ in 2021. Stay tuned for more information in the e-newsletter and on the church website and social media channels. Number two, thank you to everyone who joined us last Saturday for the final churchwide check-in in 2020, where we connected and provided updates for each of the ministries. See the church website for highlights. And 2021, until we are able to resume in-person services, we will be meeting bi-monthly so that we can remain connected through Zoom. Number three, Unscripted, the bi-weekly young adult forum on contemporary issues, faith, and scripture, has ended for the year. We will resume on Thursday, January 14, 2021 at 6:30 p.m. Watch for more information on new topics and special guests. And just a reminder, please join us today for our last prayer call in 2020. The Young Adult Check-In Prayer Call will continue next year, every second and fourth Sunday at 4 p.m. Number four, as the pandemic continues to surge and the economy turns downward, the need for food assistance is even greater. With this increase in demand, New Salem's Bread of Life Food Pantry needs more volunteers to help distribute food and other essential items each week. If you are interested in volunteering your hands and heart, please go to the church website under Bread of Life Food Pantry to register. And number 5, thank you all for joining us each week for Wellness Wednesday. It has been a fun and informative 9 months learning from our talented members serving as expert guests on our show. Wellness Wednesday will return next year on Facebook Live at 5 o'clock p.m., Wednesday, January 6, 2021. All of these announcements can be found on church.newsalemcares.org or in the link below. Please follow us on social media for updates and information throughout the week. These are your top 5 announcements. Have a wonderful week.
Hey, bow our heads for the benediction. God, thank you for reminding us. You didn't move. We've had a lot of distractions. A lot of things in our life got turned upside down these last 9 months. But you had a way of shutting some things down and reminding us of time we thought we didn't have. You give us more than enough time to commune and get back in sync with you. God, bless these, your people. Not just the New Salem family, but bless your children worldwide. God, we thank you for loving us. We thank you for protecting us. We thank you for seeing about us. God, we ask you to continue to bless this ministry and have it be in your will and your way. We ask in your son's name. Amen, amen, and amen.